There are literally, look at that morning prayer. Starts with Tulsi Mata Ki Jai, Ganga Mata Ki Jai, Go Mata Ki Jai, ends with Lok Kalyan Ho. Let the whole world be happy. That is the foundation of this nation. Nobody teaches it in classroom, but that is transmitted through generation, through a national spirit consciousness. That is the foundation of nationhood when it comes to the universe. When it comes to the question of ethnic, religious, linguistic diversity, our concept is Vasudhaiva. The whole world is one family. The world talked about globalization, but when they talked about globalization, they talked about global markets. When we talk about Vasudhaiva Kutumbakam, we talk about global family. Basis of our nationalism. On economic question, then a Chaktyanapu Nita. You only should consume what is left for you by the Ishvara, by the God. You should not be greedy. You should not try to take what is not required for you more than what you need. You should feed others. These are used to say that to eat one's own food is prakriti, is nature. To eat whatever is your food. To try and grab from other man's plate is vikruti. You should not grab it from the other man's plate. But the Sanskriti is when you give your own food to the needy, to the bhuka, that is Sanskriti. So tena chaktena bhujitaha, when it comes to the question, the economic question. And the welfare question, sarve bhavantu sukhina. Let everybody be happy. In fact, a very Methodist prayer. Sarve bhavantu sukhina, sarve santu niramaya sukhina, means everybody should be happy. Happy means everybody should have a TV in his house, a refrigerator in his house, a car outside his house. He should feel happy. He should be without any diseases. Makasi dukkha bhagavane, koi rona hi nahi jivan mein. Very Methodist prayer. And then say, but what is the real punchline of this is not Sukhinasanthu. Sarve Sukhinasanthu, Sarve Sathinavaya, Sarve Padran Sathinavaya, Maksimil. Sarvepi is the operational word. Everybody should be happy. In order for everybody should be happy, in order for everybody to be happy, somebody has to sacrifice. Very communist principle. Millions, thousands of years before Karl Marx. On the environment question, Mata Prithvi Utroham Prithvya. He said, the whole universe, the whole environment should be treated as mother. Today, the world is coming to that idea. You have to respect the environment, the ecology. It's the new idea today. But he said it long ago. On the question of diversity, religious diversity, which we see, and we fight all the time over it. Our foundation, our national foundation was Ekamsatutraha Bhujan Padami. Truth is one. Wise men interpret it in different ways. Friends, these are the foundations on which an emotional, spiritual nation was built in this country. That's the reason why this nation did not collapse when rulers changed. How many people came and ruled over this country? Within the country, outside the country. But did this rashtram, this nation perish? It survived. It surprised even a person like Muhammad Iqbal, who had to finally admit, Yuvunana Mishra Roma, sab mit gaye yahan pe, kuch baat hai ki hasti mitti nahi hamari. There is something in this land that this nation doesn't perish. Yunan gaya. Mishra, Egypt gaya, Iraq gaya, Odesh gaya, something is there in this land. That something is this ethical, spiritual idea, the basis of this nationhood. Friends, I will enumerate four challenges to this nationhood and ending, end my speech. The first challenge is the Semitic challenge. Semitic challenge not in the sense of any religion, but Semitism comes with a supranational thinking. The supranational idea of the Semites does not accept the Indian concept of spiritual, ethical idea of nation. The nation, in that sense, is purely religious. The entire religious nation is the supranational. supranational identity for the woman. Article. There were informations in Europe. There was no information in Islamic Semitism. It continued. But in Christian Semitism, there was reform. Reformist movements came. Then the nations started appearing after about 2 centuries ago. This is the first challenge that we face. We faced it badly, and it led to partition of India also once. If we do not want another partition, we need to address the Semitic challenge that is posed to the idea of Indian nationalism. The second challenge is the separatist challenge. The forces of partition, they were actively supported by the separatist thinkers, like the communists, the left, who believed, as I said, that India is not a nation, it's a nation, it's actually a conglomerate of 16 nations. As we have, today, you join. There is this challenge that no, we don't accept that this is one nation because there are 16 languages. Wait, there are not 16, there are 3,800 dialects in this country. Does it mean it's 3,800 nations? Separatist challenge is the second. Third challenge is secular challenge. The secular liberal understanding of nation is completely European understanding. Many were victims of it. I would say even our constitutional founding fathers were victims of it. That's why our constitution starts with the statement, we the people of India. Do you know, in Constituent Assembly there was a big debate over this. Whether we should call ourselves we the people of India in Article 1. You know, Article 1 starts with we the people of India. Many argued that we should call we the Indian nation. But I don't want to name a leader because I don't want to anyone of you to think negative about them. But some leaders argued that no, we are not a nation. We are caste leaders. Our consciousness is not national, national consciousness. Ours is a caste consciousness. So we cannot be called a nation. We can only be called a people. A nation has to be made through this constitution. So this is what I mean by secular challenge. In fact, there was an attempt to insert the word secular right at the time of constitution making itself. But then Nehru and Ambedkar both agreed that India should be secular in broad sense. Like you should not discriminate against any religion and all that. But then they raised an important issue. They said India is a cultural nation. It's a spiritual nation. The European understanding of secularism, this understanding can apply to it. For the French, secularism means separation of church and religion. For the Americans, freedom of religion. That is the same. Which is secularism you take in India? So they said there is no need. We are anyway cultural, we are anyway civilizationally secular, so there is no need for it. But it continues. So secular challenge is equally an important challenge. Now remember, secularism is a fact. We don't realize that secularism is there in this country all the time. When there was no secularism concept in the rest of human secular, in the sense. But when we talk about it, not even knowingly we talk about it. You know, there was, in 50s, there was a lot of discussion about secularism. Dharma Nirpeksha, it used to be called. There was some debate going on in the parliament one day. Pillu Modi, some of you might have heard about him, a very senior politician, a very jovial politician. He one day stood up and asked the speaker, sir, I have a very important question. I am not able to understand. Mantri ji, Adha Ghanta se bhashan dere, India should be dharma nirpeksha, dharma nirpeksha. I was looking at him, and then I was looking at you. But I was looking at you, aapke piche ke kamne ke upar Ashok Chakra hai, uske niche likha hua hai, dharma chakra pravartana hai. Now, what is to be taken? Dharma nirpeksha should be taken, or dharma chakra pravartana should be taken? Speaker saab looked at the minister. Bhai, kya kehte ho? Minister kaha, sir, Pillu Modi saab to bahut intelligent aadmi hai, humne to kabhi padha hi nahi tha. ना पढ़ते हैं ना समझते हैं अ चैलेंज फ्रेंड्स द लास्ट चैलेंज हियर आई विल एंड प्रॉब्ली इज अ सीरियस वन इट हैज टू बी अंडरस्टूड स्टे थिंकिंग दैट दे आर द नेशन इज एनी स्टेट एनी पॉलिटिकल एंटिटी थिंग आई then that also is a challenge because in India, we never regarded state and nation as identical, synonymous, they are not the same. State is always regarded as one of the institutions of the nation. When I say state becomes nation, simple example, it is an issue of advanced study. It's a civic institution. State may fund it, may not fund it. It has to be an independent civic entity. India has that culture. India ka gurukul, kabhi bhi kisi raja ka under nahi tha. Raja came, raja went. State has to understand that in India, respect for nation is what is mandated, and that is what is called patriotism, not respect for state. Today, they both become synonymous. Sometimes, we even, out of enthusiasm, we declare that somebody who is not loyal to my state becomes aggressive. This discourse also has to be used carefully. The word anti-national very freely, liberally we use these days. Not about loyalty to a state, policy of a state. If you deposit them, disagree with them. So these four are the challenges to India's idea of nationhood. Friends, I'm very thankful to Professor Saab for giving me this opportunity. I'll just conclude with one quote from Rishi Aurobindo. Rishi Aurobindo described Indian approach to nationalism in the following words. In India, we do not recognize the nation as the highest sympathy. Even nation is not final for us. There is a higher synthesis, humanity. Beyond that, there is a still higher synthesis, this living, suffering, aspiring world of creatures. The synthesis of Buddhism. There is a highest of all, the synthesis of God. And that is Hindu synthesis, the synthesis of Vedanta. Because today, nationalism is our immediate practical faith and gospel, not because it is the highest possible synthesis, but because it must be realized in life if we are to have the chance of realizing the others. We must live as a nation before we can live in humanity, that is, we can live as Rashtra. Thank you. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, Ramadaji. Friends, normally we introduce the speaker before he speaks, but I deliberately did not do that because I wanted you to hear what Ramadaji had to say. We all know him as one of India's leading creative thinkers. I've known him for some years now, and I can tell you that 10 years from now, 20 years from now, the people who occupy the highest offices in various walks of life in India will be chosen by Ramadaji for his own team. So he thinks 20, 30 years ahead, and I don't want to tell you about his many achievements. His most recent book was Because India Comes First, Reflections on Nationalism, Identity and Culture. If you've read this book, some of these ideas are also present there. He writes regularly for many newspapers. If you read Indian Express, every other week you'll see his column. And it'll be a column which will set the tone for thinking. It'll be ahead of its time. He's not reflecting what people have already said. He's also a founder and Board of Governor member of India Foundation, which is one of India's most important strategic think tanks today. But to come to his talk, you heard Ramadaji's idea of the nation, which was to me an integral idea, which combines many elements that we've heard of before, but makes an emotional connection and a spiritual awakening as the foundation of the idea of the nation. And I was reminded of Sri Aurobindo's little booklet called Bhavani Mandir, which he wrote when he was in Baroda, 1905-6, and then he went to Bengal became the principal of National College, which later became Jadavpur. So in Bhavani Mandir, he gives the concept of India as Bhavani Bharati. And that awakening of the soul that we were talking about. And the other very important thing that is, you jump a little bit from the Uttar Para speech of Shorobindo, he was incarcerated in the Alipur bomb conspiracy, he was released. And that's before, that's 1909-10, before he went to Pondicherry, you see. 1910 he went to Pondicherry actually, via Chandranagar. But in the Uttar Para speech, he made some very important points about the connection between India, Indian nationalism, and Sanatan Dharma, you see. And the point that Shorobindo made, and later, when other people got into it, see, in fact, Gandhiji wrote Hind Swaraj 1909, Savarkar wrote the first Indian War of Independence 1909, Tagore wrote Swadeshi Samaj 1904, where he talks about society and not state, you know, one of the core challenges is statist thinking. Gandhi also wanted Swaraj. He didn't want a top-heavy state controlling every aspect of the citizen's life. So all these ideas together were like a rishi tapasya of modern times, out of which India was born. And the point I'm trying to make is India is not born for its own aggrandizement. India is born because the consciousness has to be spread across the world. And it's that consciousness, ancient wisdom, we want to call it the modern thinking, combine it in some ways, which will take us away from suicide and modernity. You know, COVID-19 is an example of what happens when human consumption, development, technology, a techno-modern civilization, which is intrinsically violent, as Gandhi said, runs amok into the borders between the animal kingdom. We interact with monkeys every day, and human beings. You see, these are zoonotic viruses, they jump. So when you destroy the habitat of, you know, the animals, they also have a right to the planet. It's not, see, this humanism, human-centric civilization, has reached a peak. The earth also belongs to non-humans. Ahimsa also should extend to non-humans. It's not only to each other. So, you see, India is the custodian of ancient wisdom. It was there in Egypt also. It was there in other parts of the world. It's not that it's exclusive. It's an open wisdom tradition. And the modern rishis who made India wanted India to be a strong nation with a good state. Maybe the army goes. Shanti Sena se kaam nahi hota. Gandhi said, he wrote to Hitler, my dear friend, some people have asked me to write to you to change your heart. See, you can't change your heart if you're Hitler, or even for that matter, a Stalin or a Mao. So, you know, fetishizing non-violence is one of the difficulties of that. But the point that we're trying to make is that India rises not just for itself, but because there is a consciousness revolution which needs to happen. Which can save the planet, which can save mind, which can save Gaia, which can save Mother Earth, as we want to save Mother Earth. So, thank you so much, Ramadhaji. We have some time for question and answers, please. And then we listen to Governor Sahib. See, but after he speaks, there's nobody to speak. We will only have maximum. That is the protocol. After Governor, nobody speaks. Because he has the last word. And we eagerly look forward, because he is a very inspired speaker. We have invited him here earlier on the 1st of August, last year, 1st of October, pardon me. We started our Gandhi 150 with Governor Sadia. And so we eagerly look forward to learning him. But if you comment some Q&A for Ramadhanji,
I want to say something about Gandhi.
Please, we'll give you a mic. We'll just give you a mic. Sir,
no, my point is, Gandhi would not have been Gandhi had he not written to Hitler. Hitler would not have been Hitler had he written to Gandhi.
That is so. See, Hitler never bothered to write back. That's a different matter. But you know, Gandhi believed in the infinite possibilities of love, ahimsa, compassion to change the other person's heart. You know, and that is true. Love has infinite capacity. We are the instrumental actors. And mean, I see myself and I'm struggling, and I see my limitations. My capacity, my purity of intent was high enough. You would not, I mean, the conflicts I myself face, maybe you would not have faced. So I see my limitations. The instrument is limited, love is not limited. And that's what, I mean, when you say Ishavasya Vilasarama, the Lord's power cannot be limited by place or time. But I, you know, I want you to ask difficult questions to Ramanuji. I want to say one more thing with Ramanuji's permission. You know, obviously, Ramanuji belongs to a tradition. You know, he has an Arisal background. You know, his own name, Ram, comes from Bariram. The great Hegrevaji. Mother comes from Mother Sadashi Guru. He's steeped in that, but he's the most liberal, one of the most liberal people I know. Most liberal. He listened to
Happy Guru to Family Tree
over. Why? He can listen to every point of view. I've seen him. And I want to say, you know, after Arun Jaitley's passing, there is one person who can talk to everybody. And he can make alliances. He ke saath irani banaya tha. No, main baat keh raha hu. He's an asset. He can, so he's the most liberal person, one of the most liberal persons I know. And therefore you can ask him any question. It can be as difficult as you like, you know, as challenging as you like. Chair saab. So only ask the first thing.
Always ask this difficult question, sir. There is a particular way of introducing. At the outset, I would like to.
But please be brief. There is a question, no long comment.
No,
I request you, please ask a question, please.
I would like to submit your say that. Talk was very quite interesting. आपने कई सारे चुटकुले सुनाए, काफी सारी बातें करी. But I was actually missing the theme, actual theme of your address in your talk. Ethical foundation of Japanese. And here I would also draw your attention to your referencing Ambedkar in this whole debate. अम्बेडकर का आपने थोड़ा सा जिक्र किया, स्पिरिचुअलिटी की बात करी आपने, लेकिन अम्बेडकर का पूरा एक डिस्कोर्स है इससे. ही हैज सेड मेनी थिंग्स अबाउट नेशन एंड नेशनलिज्म इन हिज राइटिंग. उस पर मैं सोच रहा था कुछ और चीजें आप कहेंगे, लेकिन आपने छोड़ दिया. जिन चैलेंज की आप बात कर रहे थे, मुझे बड़ा अजीब लगा था उसमें आपने रियल चैलेंज, द चैलेंज ऑफ कास्ट, उसको तो आपने छोड़ ही दिया. और अम्बेडकर के शब्दों में ही कहूँ, वो कहते हैं कि विदाउट डिस्ट्रॉइंग और एनिहिलेटिंग द कास्ट सिस्टम यू कैनॉट बिल्ड ए मॉरलिटी. यू नो, यू कैनॉट बिल्ड ए मॉरलिटी, यू कैनॉट बिल्ड ए नेशन. एंड एक थ्योरी है कि देर आर मिलियंस ऑफ नेशन इन दिस कंट्री. वो थ्योरी शायद इसी कंटेक्स्ट में है. तो 8,000-5,000 जातियाँ हैं हमारे देश में. और सर, मैं एक अपना पर्सनल लाभ को एग्जांपल दूं, मेरा अपना एक्सपीरियंस. मैं जिस शहर में रहता हूं, मेरे बगल में एक दूसरी बिरादरी के व्यक्ति रहते हैं. हम लोग कभी एक दूसरे घर में कभी जाते हैं, क्योंकि मेरा जो है बैकग्राउंड अलग है, उनका अलग है. लेकिन हम दोनों क्योंकि अच्छे पड़ोसी हैं, मैं प्यार प्रेम रखता हूँ पड़ोसियों से, तो वो हम एक दूसरे की जो वो बीच की दीवार है उससे बात करते हैं. अच्छा, बात जब करते हैं सर, आप जरा नोट करना, जब बात करते हैं मुझे ऐसा नहीं लगता कि हम दो पड़ोसी बात कर रहे हैं. मुझे ऐसा लगता है दो नेशन बात कर रहे हैं. वो इस तरह से बात करते हैं कि सर फला गांव में एक आदमी था, वो आपके कास्ट का. मैं बड़ा हैरान हो जाता हूँ, फला गांव का वो आदमी जो मेरी सो कॉल्ड मेरी कास्ट का है, उसका मेरे से क्या संबंध है? मेरा संबंध तो मेरे पड़ोसी से है, उसके दुख सुख में मैं काम आता हूँ, मैं वो मेरे काम आते हैं. ये वो फलाना व्यक्ति मेरा इतना क्लोज कैसे हो गया, मेरा पड़ोसी? ये है सर रियल थ्रेट, ये रियल चैलेंज, इसकी आपने जिक्र ही नहीं किया.
आ, आ, आ,
तो सर देखिए जब आप सारी ये जो बड़ी बड़ी आइडियलिस्टिक बातें कर रहे हैं और स्पिरिचुअल और अंबेडकर ने स्पिरिचुअलिटी की बात करी है, नो डाउट, लेकिन अंबेडकर ये नहीं मानते कि इंडिया इज ए नेशन. ही हैज सेड कैटेगोरिकली इंडिया इज नॉट इवन टू बी फिट टू बी कॉल्ड ए यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स ऑफ इंडिया. और आप बात कर रहे हैं नेशन सदियों से, तो नेशन
आई गॉट इट,
नेशन तो बनाना है.
ये आर्गुमेंट है, मैं यही कह रहा था. कुछ लोगों का ये भाग मानना है कि यूरोपियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट में इंडिया नेशन नहीं है, अंबेडकर ने भी माना था. इसलिए वन पर्सन हु सेड इंडिया शुड नॉट बी कॉल्ड इंडियन नेशन, इट शुड बी कॉल्ड पीपल इंडिया, द पीपल, वी द पीपल ऑफ इंडिया, इट वॉज अंबेडकर. फेयर एनफ, ही हैज हिज ओन व्यूज ऑन दैट. बट अंबेडकर ऑल्सो सेड दैट फाउंडेशंस ऑफ नेशन शुड बी स्पिरिचुअल, दैट ऑल्सो यू आर मेंशनिंग. रिमेंबर, probably you have not heard my speech carefully, you only heard the circle. Because I gave 6 important ethical foundations of this nation. On economic idea, on social idea, on political idea, on global idea, on ethnic idea, on environmental idea, what are the foundations on which this spiritual nation was created? We are the followers of the idea that India has been an ancient rashtram, not necessarily a nation in the modern Western European sense. We believed in that. Maybe somebody else, maybe you have a different idea that no, India was never a nation, we have to build a new nation now. There can be different views. Different views existing, the beauty of this nation, this rashtram, they should exist. We should have a vaad or samvaad. Ambedkar had a definite view about India's nationalism and national identity. He raised this question in the context of Muslims also. You did not mention that. He said, Muslims, Pakistan, Pakistan, in Pakistan, Pakistan, he raised it, that India's nationality is the biggest problem because Muslims don't believe in it. Everybody quotes only at his or her convenience only. We refer to leaders only as per our convenience. So, there are thoughts and thoughts about nationalism in India. I was coming from the profound nationalism idea of Aurobindo, Tagore, even Ambedkar, Gandhi. Gandhi and Ambedkar did not say to I on many issues. Gandhi and Ambedkar. Gandhi's view on caste was different. Ambedkar's view was totally different. Yet, the beauty was both came to an agreement and understanding. And Ambedkar was in the forefront throughout. Because Gandhi also fully supported that Ambedkar should be in the forefront in framing the constitution, despite the fact that we had difference of opinion. That is the essence of this rashtram, this nation, this national identity. On the question of caste, I would certainly say that we come from the school of thought which believes that caste is an outdated institution and it should go lock, stock and barrel. It should go. There's no doubt about it. But the question that you and I should ask is, how would it go? Is it by some sort of revolution? Or is it by denial? Or is it by way of making certain larger identity for people? As you very rightly said, why should somebody identify you with your caste in some other village? Can there be a larger, greater identity? That greater identity can be India's national identity, India's identity as one ancient ethical spiritual nation. In that, caste as an institution came, it was an institution, it outlived its utility, we should go. But remember, when an institution goes, it will be replaced by something else. If tomorrow IIAS is closed down here, this building will not remain vacant, something else will come. Unless you think about what is the something else, simply you cannot remove that. It has to go, but in its place, what should come? It also to be very seriously thought about. Everybody thought about it. Even Ambedkar thought about it. Everybody thought that this caste system must go, but in its place, something else has to come. What is the something else? How do you keep the nation's unity intact? That should be also a very important question to ponder over. Otherwise, I agree with you. Caste should go.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Some other questions? Yes, at the back. Please introduce yourself and then we'll go to the last.
Good evening, sir. This is Bhanu Lomi from Tribune.
I have two questions.
One is similar to...
Later, please. Okay. Yes, we have time to take पहले हमारे अध्यक्षताओं को मैं आमंत्रित करता हूँ, आप कुछ सवाल करें। राजीव जी हैं, पटेल साहब हैं, हमारे अभिषेक जी हैं, किसी को भी कुछ सवाल करना है, फर्स्ट टू आवर फेलोज प्लीज। थैंक यू सर। देन द प्रेस, प्रेस विल हैव अ सेपरेट स्मॉल प्रेस ऑन टोल पर यू गेट इनफ टाइम।
Civilizational basis to well, not nationhood, but just a civilization, and that's the whole idea of Pandya's basis of history. That's the idea which Huntington picks up, and that's the idea which Trump is still pursuing. They don't even want to talk of nation because a nation is ephemeral on the historical timescale. Look at the borders of Pakistan. Bangladesh did not exist some 50 years ago. It has come into existence. So nations come into existence, go out of existence. And so why don't we just talk of civilization as Huntington talks, and then within that we talk about what the Indian civilization is. Instead of getting bogged down into the word nation, which of course has tremendous political significance and so on, but from the historian's point of view, from the philosopher's point of view, it may be better just to talk of a civilization. And certainly we can talk of an Indian civilization going far back into the past. Nobody can deny it.
Thank
so
thank
I would like to ask, why are we just totally stuck on this word nation? Why don't we simply work with the idea of a civilization?
Okay.
And we can have both concepts if you like, but I mean, I would personally prefer just the concept of a civilization.
Thank you, Professor Raju. Thank you.
It's the view. I also said that nation, as we understand as a European concept, is irrelevant for India. We need to, what we call a civilizational nation is what I said, Rashtra.
Okay. Very good. Yes, Professor Dataram Pugal is from Uttarakhand, works on folklore.
One question always haunts my mind. We have a constitution, and we are bound together by the Constitution. But I believe that we are more knit together by our culture, as you also said it. So I belong to a person sitting down there in Rameswaram because of the culture. I am one with the man sitting there in Assam, Kamakhya Devi. Or I belong to a person sitting there in Kashmir. So which is more important, to keep this country together, the constitution or the culture?
Sir, I enjoyed listening to you, and you are a different thinker from the right wing. And I always appreciate the points you make, which is slightly different, and as sir has pointed out, ahead of time in some ways. But as because my teacher Subhasachi Bhattacharya figured very prominently in the introduction of Professor Ranjpet, I would like to submit that it's true that in the first decade, rishis, if you use that word, started to talk back the title of the book Professor Chakravarti has written, talking back with the civilizational notion. But we continue to talk not back to the West, but among ourselves. And there lies the problem. The people had foundational notions about what constitutes the nation, from Aurobindo to Savarkar and Gandhi, Tagore obviously. But thereafter, things started to roll in different directions. And these contestations are very, very important. And if we keep bringing the first decade's thought, the historical context was different. For the first time, India was talking back to the West. But when we started talking among ourselves, then the person who has raised this question, if the neighbor becomes a foreign issue. And that is where the real challenge of nationalism comes before us. When we talk with our neighbor, where from the differences, the basis of differences, come into the play. And that is where I would like to address.
Very well put. Now I think we'll wind up the question. Sir, you can ask the question. Please, go ahead. He's a part of the security detail, but he's an intellectual, so we're very happy. Thank you.
Sir, in your speech, sir, you happened to mention about Israel and how it went on to become a nation. So do we feel that the fate of the country, the places that are struggling to become a nation, especially for example Tibet, do we feel that they have the same code to, they are going to become the nation because of the one value they contain, similar to Israel?
Thank you. And how long will they have to wait? 2,000 years. So
Not much is there for me to answer as such, because they were very important and very profound observations. I thank all the scholars who have made such important interventions. I do state that the very fundamental unity of this country, of this people, is because of this ancient national consciousness only. Not because of governments or not because of political institutions, but because of the ancient idea of this consciousness of this nationhood, which is based on those 4 or 5 pillars that I mentioned, the ethical foundations that I mentioned. That is the basis of our nation's unity, and other observations are very valid. I thank them for giving me that insight about such important points. As far as the Tibetans are concerned, they are our guests. We wish them well. India believes in Atithi Devo Bhava. They are like our very beloved people for us. What should be their future will be decided by them. If the Tibetan nation has to come back, they will decide and they will fight for it. They will achieve it. I think we all should have great respect for their sentiment and their feelings.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I can tell you that Ramadaji has personally worked and connected with the prominent people of the Tibetan nation. And he's very deeply involved in that cause. But I will now, just before inviting Governor Sahib, I just wanted to say one or two words. You know, the debate on the notion of whether a nation has a soul or not is a very deep and profound one in the Indian context. Because in India, there's a big debate about the soul itself. See, for example, the Buddhists will say anatmavad, you know. We say atmavad. And the Jains will say as many souls as lives, you know. And Anyan has infinite souls. So, these positions are not contradictory. I'm coming back to your point, Jal Sahib. But the really important thing is, however you conceive of the idea of the soul, of the spirit, as an essence, as an absence, you know, shunyata, whatever. The important thing is, even in Tibetan Buddhism, Mahayana Buddhism, you know, the consciousness rises from the illumined ground of being. And whether you're a Jain, you want Kaivalya, Buddhists want nirvana, we want moksha among the Hindus, the Sanatani, the core Sanatani. You see, and the non-Sanatani, वहाँ तक भी चल जाएगा, but anti-Sanatani होता है, तब थोड़ी सी मुश्किल आती है, you see. So, these are the threats you also mentioned, the Semitic, you know, the separatists, the secular, the status. These are for me very important dimensions of how to frame the questions and frame the challenges in front of us. And they transcend political parties and the politics that we hear about every day. These are deeper, profound civilizational questions. Thank you so much, Ramadaji. We look forward to receiving your script. We want to publish your observations. You have, okay, last question, Rajviji. He is the Fellows Council representative, so I cannot see who to. जी सर जी,
वो ये है कि राम माधव जी ने जो आज लेक्चर दिया है, तो उसके डिफरेंट डायमेंशंस को लेकर के आई विश टू कॉम्प्लीमेंट हिम फॉर दैट एक्सीलेंट प्रेजेंटेशन। दूसरी चीज ये है कि राम माधव जी ने दो बातें कही और मुझे लगता है कि वो एक बहुत ही बहुत जरूरी बात कही है, दैट टू अंडरस्टैंड द नेशन एंड नेशनहुड इन इंडियन कॉन्टेक्स्ट we should have to go and refer to the Indian sources,
correct,
not the European sources. If we continue to read only European literature on nation and nationhood, perhaps we will not be able to understand the concept of chitti and soul. We will have to read what chitti is and where it is referred to. And then, of course, we can deliberate on that. So, compliment to you, sir.
Thank you, Professor Sharma. कल भी ये बात आई थी डीजल को लेके, नेशनैलिटी को लेके, एंड आई सबमिटेड समथिंग सिमिलर दैट इंडियन नोशन द रीजन आर आल्सो डिफरेंट, दे आर नॉट द सेम एज यूरोपियन रीजन, एंड विदाउट चिति, यू नो, विदाउट चेतना, विदाउट कॉन्शियसनेस, विदाउट बुद्धि, विदाउट विवेक, विदाउट प्रज्ञा, हाउ कैन यू टॉक अबाउट रीजन इन इंडिया? यू कांट टॉक अबाउट रीजन इन अ प्योरली एनलाइटनमेंट सेंस और अ प्योरली मटेरियलिस्ट रीजन. Doesn't work in the Indian civilization. The same point came yesterday. So, thank you. I just want to say a word about our honored chief guest, Sri Bandaru Dattatreya Ji, the Honorable Governor of Himachal Pradesh. He has been very gracious to us at IIAS, and we are very grateful to you, sir. Again, you have come and helped us, and you are blessing us. Thank you. I want to just say two words about him. That our governor sahab, he was in prison during the emergency. He's had a long, distinguished career. He was in the Lok Sabha from the Secunderabad constituency in 1991. And he was also appointed the president of the party, that is Bharatiya Janata Party. He was also re-elected under Atal Bihari Vajpayee government. He served as a Union Minister of State for Urban Development. He was also elected the third time in the Lok Sabha. He served as Minister of State again. And later, he became the party's National Vice President. And he's had a very, very, and now 2014, he was the only, if I remember, the only BJP Lok Sabha member from the Telangana region, if I'm right, please correct me, sir. And he became the Minister of State for Labour and Employment in the first Narendra Modi ministry in 2014. So with these words, and he's an engineer, Ramanuj is an engineer, I wanted to say that as a word. But our Honourable Governor Sahib has a science degree. And we welcome you, sir. You can speak from there if you like. You can use the mic, or you can come as you wish. Thank you, sir.
From central and state governments, friends from media, brothers and sisters. I feel specially privileged to preside over 7th Tagore Memorial Lecture because Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore ji was not only the doyen of Indian writers, poets, and thinkers, but also a visionary who foresaw a rising India and contributed to nation building in many remarkable ways. He has been synonymous with high ethical standards and pioneering spirit of civilization, development, and philosophical humanism. I am happy that the tradition of academic research and ethical responsibility towards society continues today at the Institute. The Tagore Center for the Study of Culture and Civilization, which is part of Indian Institute of Advanced Study, Shimla, has areas of research and academic engagement that blend seamlessly with the broad mandate of Institute to reflect upon the complexity of the human condition in a manner that is free from prejudice and open to plural readings. Its Tagore Center seeks to advance the study of elements of Tagore humanist philosophy and his cosmopolitanism. The center was inaugurated by Sri Pranab Mukherjee, President of India, on 24th May 2013 at Shimla. On this occasion, he also delivered the first Rabindranath Tagore lecture. It was auspicious beginning that established the Tagore Center on firm foundations. I congratulate you for inviting Sri Ram Madhavji to deliver the prestigious 7th Rabindranath Tagore Memorial Lecture. The Indian Institute of Advanced Study, Shimla, is a premier institution for higher learning and research, not only in the country, but around the globe. Sri Ram Madhavji has served as the National General Secretary of the BJP, but I know him as a dedicated core specialist and important thinker. We have all heard his illuminating lecture. And yes, very interesting. Yes, put forth the picture how the Indian nationalism concept originated from ancient culture. And today, many of our friends, they should know it, how this Indian nation origination has come. This history has to be reached in the current books of society. Because the younger generation and the modern generation, they don't have the idea of national civilization state. All the spiritual thinking of the nation. And that's why the Rabindra Ramadan is in the original thought. What he has mentioned is solar energy. देश की आत्मा इस बात के ऊपर जो है ज्यादा विचार इसके ऊपर ज्यादा और जो है इसके ऊपर ज्यादा हिंदी में पढ़ लिखा I am very happy to say that the institute has managed very well both pandemic as well as the academic challenge. To continue during this period, I notice the presence of enviable record of 25 fellows, some of whom are joining through a web link. You have managed to hold weekly fellows seminars as well as continue with your distinguished lecture series. With important speakers such as General Atta Asani, Ambassador Navdesh Sarna, Member of Parliament and Mr. Dr. Swapnadas Gupta, Sri Veer Singhvi, Historian Dr. Vikram Sampath and so on. We have also started, despite COVID-19, the comprehensive repair and restoration of bulk of this heritage building. For the first time, office was built in 1888. For this, I congratulate you. This historic building was witnessed to our seven first year. Dear sisters and brothers, the theme of the today's lecture by Sri Ram Babaji was Ethical Foundation of Nationalism. I must compliment Indian Institute of Advanced Study, Shimla, for this theme, as it not only generates such positive thoughts and feelings about the inherent strength of our nation, but reminds us of glorious past and need to strive further continuously for building a bright, prosperous and inclusive India. Whenever there is a time of disaster in the country or any kind of emergency arises with our country on the borders, every Indian has a glimpse of nationality. Recently, in the time of China, there was a feeling of unity among the countrymen, and it should also come, which is necessary in defeating the adversary. National integration is the bond and togetherness between people regardless of their caste, creed, religion or gender. It is the feeling of oneness, brotherhood and social unity under communities and society in a country. National integration helps to keep the country unified and strong from within despite diversity. So, the importance of the national integration can be from the fact that the nation which remains integrated, it will always progress on the track of development and prosperity. But I believe that this sense of national unity should always remain. It is not just a situation arising out of speech or an emergency. But it is an awakening feeling in the soul we should remain always. Maitri Sharan Gupta Ji ka kya pankhya aapne school mein padhi hogi. Bara nahi jo bhavo mein. Bhauti jisme rasdar nahi. Sadai nahi aur patar hai. जिससे प्रदेश का पत्थर नहीं इसमें प्रदेश का पत्थर भरा नहीं जो भावों में बहती जिसमें रसदार नहीं हृदय नहीं वह पत्थर है जिसमें प्रदेश का प्यार नहीं नेशनल इंटीग्रेशन इंप्रूव्स The feeling of loyalty and fraternity towards the nation. It unites the people in case of any national emergency. This unity also shows the way of development and progress. The most important thing is to take
inspiration from our heritage and great personalities. This inspiration dedicates us to service to a nation with morality, and it also helps in keeping the country united. It is a matter of great pride for us that our nation is rising in stature in various fields, be it economic, academic, geopolitical influence, defense, sports, science, IT, space, technology. Above all, we are proud of being the world's largest and most vibrant democracy of about 133 crore aspirational Indians, representing a vast diversity of religions, regions, castes, cultures, and traditions. The foundations of the democracy are supported by strong institutions of parliament and judiciary, a dynamic private sector, and independent and vibrant media. The fundamentals of Indian economy are strong, and India continues to be among the fastest growing major economies of the world. India has moved 14 places in the World Bank EWS Business Ranking and is placed at 63rd place among 190 nations. This has been possible due to extensive economic reforms. Economic reforms initiated by Honorable Prime Minister Sri Narendra Modi. One of the Gurudev Rabindranath Tagore's exquisite poem also comes to my mind in this regard, because it emphasizes essential human values that constitute the Indian ethos. He had said in his famous book, Sadhana, "This is the noble heritage from our forefathers, waiting to be claimed by us as our own. This ideal of supreme freedom of consciousness, it is not merely intellectual or emotional. It has an ethical basis, and it must be translated into action. In the Upanishads, it is said, the supreme being is all-pervading. Therefore, he is the innate good in all. To be truly united in knowledge, love, and service with all beings, and thus to realize oneself in all-pervading God, is the essence of goodness. And this is the keynote of teachings of Upanishads, life is immense. This attitude is what makes India unique. Let us celebrate the sense of fellow being. Let us spread the message of peace and promote the ability to learn, live, and grow together. I wish the Institute and eminent fellows all the best in their quest for excellence in future. Jai Hind, Jai Himachal.
Thank you, friends. We will have a brief vote of thanks and then the national anthem. I want to request all of you to remain standing as the Honorable Governor exits. The others can also exit after him. And my friends from the press can come here in the first row with social distancing. No crowding to the front, please. We will now... Anyhow, sir, thank you for your address. And मुझे लगता है कि साधना से संकल्प की ओर और संकल्प से सिद्धि की ओर हम बढ़ेंगे. बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद. कर्ण साहब, give a vote of thanks, please. And then we'll stand for the national anthem. And foremost, with deep sense of gratitude, let me thank the Honorable Governor for his
taking the time out to come over here and preside over the 7th Elope Memorial Lecture. And sir, we remember that you were here with us and you graced us and you blessed us, the Institute, on 1st of October last year as well. Thank you so much, sir. Next, I extend my deepest gratitude to Rama Ji, sir, your vision on the lecture and your talk on a very relevant topic of the formation of national ego. It was a matter of honor for all of us to be here, to present here, and actually to be part of such an articulate and deep thinking process which we have gone through. I extend my heartfelt thanks to all the fellows, those who are present here. Thank you all very much. I also thank all the fellows who joined us through the webinar. I thank the guests, those who may be watching us through the Facebook Live, as this event is on Facebook Live. I thank all the employees, all those who are present here, those who actually did a lot of work to make this event successful. I thank our director, sir, and all other officials and functionaries. Actually, those who have taken a lot of pains and a lot of organizing this thing to arrange and get on to this important event today. I thank all my subordinates and the section heads and some of those who are day and night have been working, the system administrators and those who are in audio and ARO, SPRO, the state sections and all those. Thank you all very much. Last but not the least, I thank the friends from media that you all have been supportive of us. You all come and you all have covered our previous events also wonderfully. Thank you all. Thank you very much. May I now request all to please rise for national anthem.
Thank you.